A lot of times, if, for example, they had won the Olympics, they would have torn down all the Blake medals, put a town and gown center here, put up $1 million townhouses down the east side of the street, and ran all the so-called black middle class who moved into Lake Meadows circa 1950, 1960, moving up the economic ladder. So this is a very middle class black community which would have been totally displaced. It don't make no difference. You call the county, right? You in here, you in TK, you all subsidized housing. You just had a different level of subsidy and a different perception of that subsidy. And everybody at some point in time, you look at their family trees, needed some form of public housing. Mm-hmm. So don't say to me that once you went and got your second mortgage on your house, which you never should have done for the derivative boys who bundled those mortgages and sold them over in the money market, that's coming back on Chase Bank right now, right? Because they did a derivative game just to keep making money off of the leaseholders or the people who own the real estate. So your house is worth $200,000. You go get a short-term loan, bloom loan, three ladies popping up the street times what it was, you can't make it, or you sold it, or you done lost your job, right, in the economy. And so your house is now up for grabs. So what they doing now? Again, grabbing the real estate and now turning it back into rental units at $1,700-$1,800 a month. Wow. Right? That's the current game plan that you're going to see manifested. So it's inherently disenfranchising low-income people and specifically public housing residents without giving them any opportunity to be involved in the redevelopment of their community. So if we don't stand up to these issues, then that's what's going to happen. So this book, for me, documents it historically. And I can take you from 1890 all the way to 2016, because we're celebrating our 100-year centennial in 2016. All right? We just passed legislation in Springfield for the Great Migration Trail, passed 100%. In Springfield. How many times has the bill passed 100%? Because the white folks know they've been faking all along, so they went on in support of it, because it now enables us to find some money to help you and Robbins, Harvey, wherever we exist, we need to be trying to put a deal together big enough, and that Millennium Reserve, I think, is the opportunity to do so. Or we can look at it from a regional perspective and create these nodes on the real estate where we got these spots that you can go to in terms of understanding the history of the Great Migration experience. So that's the overarching goal. I don't have to talk much about the senior citizen program because this is a component of a senior initiative. I am now officially a senior citizen, turning 70 this year, as my brother is 70 already, but we got health issues, right? So we need to make sure we got our doctors coming through, all the other stuff that we need as seniors, the services, how do we get them on the computer, how do we get them computer literate. That's why you're sitting here. We're going to put our lab in here. We're going to put in a call center, 511 call center, right? 12, 14 bucks an hour, 24/7, right? You come sit in your computer, do your eight, get your $14 an hour. That's entry-level employment. Can you read the script, right? That's the kind of piece that we put together downstairs as we expand our facility here, and we want to go up on the back lobby of the 22-story hotel. That's been the original vision from day one, and we have not had any cooperation of any significance of getting our own politicians, let alone the right power structure, of helping to fund these kind of noble initiatives that can do what? Break the cycle of poverty among the masses of black people. That's the goal. Yeah, I said it. Break the cycle of pop. Baby need a job and a degree too, right? And if you don't have that attitude, you've taken some form of a class position on the least.